I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. Welcome, refugees, to the sanctuary where we actually practice how to take sanctuary. And the ultimate confession, it would be to say, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. So, congratulations to everyone in this world, in the universe indeed. We have beaten the universe to the punch. I am that perfect failure. Okay. We have beaten the universe to the punch. And there's perfect wisdom behind this, what we're doing here. What we're doing is we're celebrating the fact that God created us perfectly and capable of straying from what we are. Okay, so we are absolute perfect failures in straying from what we are. Okay, and this is what we have overlooked. Okay, which is why we're dreaming this dream of straying from what we are. We're dreaming a dream of bodies, of personalities, time, space, process, form, worlds, universe. Okay, this is a dream of straying from what we are, but we cannot stray from what we are. So therefore, we are perfect failures. Okay, I am that perfect failure because we are referencing in all our images and concepts and beliefs, we're referencing this dream of straying. So how do we reference this dream of straying to solve this continuity problem we have? Do we do it in a positive way, positive certain assertions, or negative? This one negative assertion. No, I am a perfect failure. I cannot stray. You know, I'm a perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. So this has been a lifelong consideration of mine. What is the way that actually works? And I find that making this negative assertion is the way. Making positive assertions doesn't work very well at all, because what it does is it keeps building up positive concepts, positive images, positive. Okay, what we really need to get is, I can't stray. Not that I can stray, that I cannot stray. So what we fundamentally need is this negative assertion. I am a complete fail. I am a perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. And you have to own it for yourself. The time has passed to beg God, please help my personality, I'm struggling. No, it's a time to thank God with great gratitude. Thank you, God, for creating me as that perfect failure that I am. Thank you, God, for creating me as that perfect failure that I am. I am that perfect failure. Now, the personality, which is not what we are, it's a mockery of what we are. It's a belief that we can stray from what we are, which is nothing but sheer arrogance on our part. The personality doesn't like this at all. It hates it. And it's frantic to get away from this. Everything in the world teaches to never say this, that I am that perfect failure. I've never heard anyone say this in this world. Never. I am that perfect failure. Because the world absolutely defends against this. The personality, the body-mind, so to speak, personality complex. Its entire effort is to make sure nobody ever says this here. No one ever says this here. That this is never said here. Because it's the end for the personality. It's the end of this dream of straying, you see. And so the ego tells us, the ego, the voice of the body-mind complex says, if you say this, you will die, you know. No, that's a projection. If we say this, the dream of straying will die, you know. We'll realize it never happened. So, by beating the universe to the punch, that means that we have this assertion now. Yes, thank you, God. Yes, thank you, God. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. Own it. Say, I am that perfect failure. See, I am that perfect failure. And this brings that begins to bring the peace, the grace of God, you begin to feel like, oh, finally I've reached refuge. I've stumbled into the oasis out of the desert. I am that perfect failure. I don't need to keep trying to succeed to stray from what I am, right? Because God created me as a perfect failure from doing that. I cannot help but fail to do that, all right? I'm a perfect failure at that. I'm an absolute perfect failure. I am that absolute perfect failure. I am that absolute perfect failure. And this is really an assertion that I'm spirit. See, I am that absolute perfect failure. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created spirit to be. I am that absolute perfect failure. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. So the ego would have us continually trying to make positive assertions like, I'm a good person. Yes, I can be happy, you know, and all this stuff. But what it wants to avoid is this negative assertion that I am this absolute perfect failure. I am that right now, right here and now. I am that absolute perfect failure. See, I can never stray even one iota from what God created me as, from my God-created identity. I can never stray one iota from my God-created identity. It's impossible. So I must therefore be this perfect, immaculate failure at this. I am that failure. So claim that failure for yourself. And this is what then liberates us from this insane dream. It provides the grace upon which liberation, the foundation of liberation, it provides the foundation. And then the intermediate step will be something which is a placeholder, so to speak. A placeholder, maybe a light body in a death-free realm like that. But we lay the foundation for our salvation by saying, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. Now, I had dreams last night, and the body, the personality is frantically trying to escape this. And I had a dream, it's going here, it's going there, it's going to Africa, looking, where are the bodies? I need a lot of bodies, you know. My gosh, but remember, the personality is not us at all. It's a mockery of what we are. It's the mockery of arrogance. It's arrogance mocking what our identity, our true identity. It has nothing to do with our identity, bodies, personality. But the problem we have is we keep trying to save the personality, keep trying to make the personality happy. This will never work. And the personality likes to hear, yes, I'm spirit, I'm beautiful, I'm one, I'm true. But this is all just trying to pump up a positive self-image, positive concepts for the personality. So the personality can claim that it's enlightened. Now, that fails. That doesn't work. That doesn't work. That's not effective. This is what I've found. But when we say, I am that absolute perfect failure, I am that perfect failure, immediately I feel a completely different context, and it's just like, wow. So this is what I've been looking for, and this is what the world has misdirected me and distracted me from. And much of spirituality is nothing but a distraction from this. All the positive spirituality is really a distraction from this, okay? Because in order to be liberated, we truly have to disidentify with this universe, with bodies, worlds, personalities, beliefs, all of that. That's an arrogant mockery of what we are. I am as God created me. I am perfect failure. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Okay. So I am that perfect failure. This is the awesome, awesome assertion. And of course, for those who are hearing it for the first time, which is probably everybody on the planet, there's a first time for everything. And I'm testing it out here. It may seem like, wow, what about my personality then? The personality, again, is an arrogant mockery of what we are. It's a denial of what we are. But I cannot stray one iota from what God God created me as. My God-created reality, I cannot stray from my God-created reality in the slightest bit. So I must forever, I must be eternal. I am that eternal, perfect failure. I must have this eternal, perfect failure to ever stray from my God-created reality. And this is our most precious gift that God created us as, is that we cannot stray from what God created us as. It's impossible to stray from it. So it's wonderful to accept this the greatest gift of God is I am this perfect failure. That's the greatest gift that God has for us. We cannot ever succeed in straying from what we are. We're immaculately perfect failures. So I am that immaculate perfect failure. I am that immaculate perfect failure. Okay. Now, we beat the universe to the punch. I call it lipstick culture at this time. That's a very good descriptive term for it, which basically the personality is so scared of spirit. Like, oh my gosh, I feel Jesus is returning. And in fact, Jesus has already returned to this planet. May 1st. The personality has long been frightened of this. And that the immaculate perfect failure is returning to this world. And Jesus brings this awareness that I am that immaculate perfect failure. And being a friend of Jesus, an apostle of Jesus, I've been able to then accept this, accept what Jesus is bringing, the wisdom that Jesus brings, the freedom that Jesus is bringing. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created spirit to be. I am that immaculate perfect failure. I am that immaculate perfect failure. I accept it. I accept it. I embrace that gift that God has given me. I am that immaculate, perfect failure. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Okay, so the personality is absolutely frantic. So it goes to image of the flesh, beautiful image of the flesh we call the goddess, and starts praying to the goddess, please make an exception for me, please make an exception. Goddess, I give you the power to make an exception to this. I am not a perfect failure. I can succeed at being a personality in a body. I can succeed. So what happens is, you know, rampant goddess worship, which this lipstick culture is inaugurating, is bringing into vogue right now. And so the personality always turns to the goddess and says, you have the power to make an exception with God. You can intercede with reality. You can make an exception. You can make some success. I can be at least part successful at being, if I worship you, you will enable me to be successful at being a body. Okay, successful at being a personality, successful at being a world, successful at being time, space, process, form, successful at being a universe, that you have the power. So we keep telling that there's this goddess that has the power to intercede with reality and bring success to what God created with as perfect failure. And so this is the religion of the personality. The goddess is the religion of the personality. Okay. And we have this lipstick culture now, which is greasing the skids into goddess worship, worship of the body, okay. Which is why we have this collapse of society, collapse of culture, collapse of morality, okay. Collapse of, you know, the whole moral structure of civilization is collapsing, and it will collapse into goddess worship. That's the worship of the personality is goddess worship, believing that the goddess has the power to intercede with reality, which is nothing but a reflection of our own arrogance. We do not have the power to intercede with reality. Okay, there is no intercession in reality whatsoever. We have to embrace reality and accept it. We have the power to accept it. That we are as God created us to be. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Now, I was certainly helped in this by Anandamayi Ma, who many people thought she was a goddess. She insisted she wasn't, actually. But in India, they're very much into goddess worship, and they felt that she was the goddess. But by seeing that, and recognizing that this is the I am presence, this is the presence of I am a perfect failure. This helped me work through this whole goddess worshiping thing, realizing, wow, no matter how beautiful you make the goddess, it's still completely false. It doesn't help us at all. It makes things worse. Now, in India, Kali worship, those who understand that properly realize Kali is this absolute, total, I am that perfect failureness. Black. Kali is black, completely black, symbolizing clear light, actually, and I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. I cannot be a body. I cannot be a personality. I cannot be a universe. I cannot be a world. It's this. It's symbolized by this total blackness, total darkness, so to speak. But that's a conceptual personality symbolization, you see. This is a pragmatic thing. So they called her Kali Ma, which you know, symbolizes this I am this perfect failure, actually. That's what ultimately symbolizes. But it's a tricky thing, because whenever you turn to a body at all, it does create a personality reaction, an attraction to bodies. So goddess worship, even the one that frees us from goddess worship, is a temporary expedient. Okay, and what we need to do is we need to go beyond that to the negative assertion. Okay, we're beyond worshiping bodies at all. We say, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am that perfect failure. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you, God. I am that perfect failure. I am the immaculate perfect failure. But it's not likely I would have ever gotten to this if it not were not for Nanda, my Ma, were helping me work through this whole goddess thing, okay, because this culture is absolutely collapsing into goddess worship, and goddess worship can seem is extremely attractive to the personality. Extremely attractive. In fact, the personality can't resist it. Okay. Now, Jesus brings the truth here, and that is, I am, yes, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. And we identify with that. As long as we're perceiving, identifying, conceptualizing, making effort, etc., the safe way is to say, I am that perfect failure. Okay. When we start getting into positive identifications, we're on a very slippery slope. Very slippery slope. And do not worship electromagnetic light. You know, it's better to see it as darkness. Ultimately, light is clear. Okay, but since we're so used to believing light is the true light is electromagnetic light, we must negate that identification, that false identification first. If we have a false identification, the intermediate step is we must negate that false identification. We must negate it. We must negate it. We say no. So, at the same time, identifying with the truth, but since we're in perception, still in perception, conceptualization, and nobody is simply going to drop all perception, all conceptualization like that. Nobody's going to do that. Continuity fear is way too severe. So from a pragmatic standpoint, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. And When I had that experience of abiding in as I am that perfect failure, in non-dual, perfect non-dual duality, it seemed like this vast darkness. But it wasn't the kind of darkness that we're used to seeing as darkness, like the lack of electromagnetic light. There was no electromagnetic light there. So I conceptualized it as this vast, peaceful darkness. But again, it wasn't like you couldn't see. It wasn't the kind of darkness we're used to. But keep in mind that we have been so addicted to conceptuality and images that we have to account for this. If we don't account for this, we're going to stumble. So don't try and get uppity and try to take a higher position. This is the failure of the intellect, okay? That's the personality just still trying to be sassy, you know, and say, well, if you say this, I'm going to say that, you know. Say no to that. Okay, understand the pragmatism of this, and that's why you have to have some faith. Because the personality can try to play word games with you. And we must have some faith and say no. Just say yes. I am that absolute perfect failure. I am that absolute perfect failure. The problem is when we say I am the light, I am the light, we automatically assume we're talking about this electromagnetic light. Automatically. We have conceptualize it, we image it, you're used to it, we're familiar with it. And this creates a false barrier. It's far better to go to the standpoint of negations. I am that perfect failure. And then when you're dwelling in this vast, seamless, measureless ocean of seeming darkness, it's not really darkness at all. But from our conceptual standpoint, we say, well, where's the electromagnetic light? There isn't any. Okay, well, it must be dark then. So that's, our mind is still imaging that, you see. But our experiencing is that it's completely clear. Okay. But just allow that. Just don't try to intellectually struggle with that. At this point, it's an experience. So don't be frightened of that at all. Don't be frightened. It's not frightening at all. Lack of electromagnetic light is not really darkness at all. Lack of a universe is not darkness at all. It's perfect clarity, actually. But perfect clarity can never be perceived, you see. It can only be experienced. So, we're just being pragmatically wise, which is what we have to be. And that, whereas the ego, the personality, you know, wants to say, well, I can do better than that, you know. No, that's just trying, that is, it knows that that will mess us up if we try to outsmart ourselves. So we don't try to outsmart ourselves here. And this is the grace of God. We don't try to outsmart ourselves. Yes, I am that perfect failure. 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 Identify. Yes, I am that perfect failure. Failure to stray one bit from what I am as God created me. I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect failure. So this is the kryptonite to the goddess culture. This to the personality, to falsity, to lies, to deceit, to self-deception, to arrogance. This is the kryptonite to arrogance. And we beat it to the punch because there's all sorts of stuff now that is happening. As we were told, Holy Spirit told me that after June 21st, all hell's going to break loose here. And it has. The Greek debt crisis is looking more and more drastic at this point. We had a big Greek dinner last night in solidarity with Greece and the Eurozone in general, saying, let's come up with the right solution here, okay? Let's not be stupid. So we broke out the feta cheese and the Kalamata olives, the tabbouleh, the garbanzo beans, and we threw in some American potato salad, macaroni salad. We had these wonderful strawberry smoothies. It's very Mediterranean, you know, Greek type of style. So those who eat meat ate grilled chicken. And it was wonderful, and we wished the very best upon the whole situation there, on all parties. Woke up this morning, Saturday morning, and the Eurozone finance ministers have denied the bailout that they offered, like $17 billion to kick the can down the road for 5 months. They said, no, we're not going to offer that. That offer has been rescinded. There is no offer on the table. The original issue is now front and center. Greek has to repay their debt by Tuesday. And then the Greek prime minister, whatever they call him, called for a snap referendum on July 5th to basically decide whether they want to reject, you know, the demands of the Eurozone entirely. This is a very bad development. Keep in mind that the Greeks were the ones responsible, by and large, for crashing the late Bronze Age culture, which was these mighty civilizations at that time, the pinnacle of civilization at that time, the sea peoples, which really came from the Aegean area around Greece. They destroyed the late Bronze Age culture, which is something that is one of the great astonishments of history, of how these sea peoples could cause the collapse of civilization. But they did. They did. It's a historic fact. And very rapid collapse and destruction. And it plunged the world into dark ages, you know, for quite some time. Well, don't underestimate the Greeks. They did it one time. History has a tendency to repeat itself. This is what gets me nervous. They did the impossible once before, the seemingly impossible. That means they could do it again. It's in their quote unquote history, in their DNA. I mean, it's you know, they have some capacity to collapse civilization. So this whole Greek death thing is not a joke at all. I mean, a lot of people say, what does it mean? Well, that's the attitude of the late Bronze Age culture, you know. What do we have to worry about? Well, didn't work out well for them, did it? So, we have this intense situation in the world, this superstorm, from all directions. And yet, we have the lighthouse now. Okay. And we have the oasis in the desert. The scorching desert. We have this beautiful oasis in the scorching desert. We have this air-conditioned oasis now. Really. Yes, I am that perfect failure. And I feel able to, like, meet Jesus on this basis way better than trying to assert some sort of positives. I always felt that positives weren't good enough. Okay? They weren't strong enough. I am, yes. I am that perfect failure. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for creating me with this perfect failureness, where I cannot stray one iota from what I am, from what you created me as. So yes, I am that perfect failure. Thank you, God. So whatever Jesus, when Jesus starts to do what he's going to do here, and he's already doing something for sure, I'll be able to meet Jesus on that basis. Yes, I am that perfect failure. Yes, Jesus, I am that perfect failure. And I have this centering, grounding, total truth that I can express. All right? And so that puts me in the right frame of mind. Because this is Jesus' message to us. Absolutely. We cannot stray one iota from what God created us as, which is spirit, which is free. Perfect freedom. Perfect freedom. No time, space, process, or form can ever touch us. Can ever touch us. No dream can ever touch us. This is his message. And we go to the goddess and say, oh, please, goddess, please reassure me that I'm the body, that it's good to be a body, that I can be a positive body, I can be a good person. Please help me be a good person, goddess. I'm so afraid that, you know, I might be a failure. I don't want to be a failure. Please save me from failure, goddess. You know, this is the personality. The personality will go worship the goddess and the idols with all their jewelry and ornamentation and beauty and all. Beauty of physical form, etc. And they say, I'm so afraid of failure. You know. Now, we're not afraid of failure. In fact, we absolutely embrace perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. Thank you, Jesus. I am that perfect failure. Thank you, Jesus. There is no intercession with this perfect failureness. I am that perfect failure. Flawless, immaculate, perfect, eternal failure. No intercession whatsoever. Success can never intercede with that. No straying from this whatsoever. I cannot stray from what I am. I cannot stray from what God created me as. I cannot stray from my God-created I amness. I cannot stray one bit from my God-created I amness. I cannot stray one bit from my God-created I amness. I am that perfect failure and ever straying, you see? And so if you wonder, well, what can I say to Jesus? Just say, hey, Jesus, thank you. I am that perfect failure. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I finally got your message. I am that perfect failure. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, yes, yes. I am that perfect failure. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Yes, I am that perfect failure. I am that. Nothing more to be said. You're just asserting your identity. I am that. I am that. I am that. I am that perfect failure. That's all we need to do is assert our identity. That's it. So simple, isn't it? Just simply assert our identity in a pragmatic way, given our continuity fear. I am that perfect failure. And this is absolute truth. We could say, it's truthful to say, God created us with this perfect failure that we can never stray from what we are. So we can never succeed at straying from what we are at all. So we have to be perfect failures at that. Have to be perfect failures at that. And so we give thanks to God for this, that we cannot stray from the perfection of I amness. We cannot stray from the perfection of I amness, because God created us that way, as perfect failures. And of course, this is from the standpoint of the pressure of the personality and of the ego and of the continuity fear, which we most certainly have this pressure on us. So in reality, we don't need to make any assertions at all. See, when we're completely free of all perception, no assertions are necessary. Zero. There's no pressure at all. But from our standpoint, we're still dreaming, we're still perceiving, there most definitely is pressure. So we must stand up to that pressure and claim our birthright as perfect failures to ever succumb to that pressure. Okay, that's the first intermediate step. I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect failure. So pressure can have no effect upon me, you see. That's how we stand up to the universe. See, hey, universe, I am that perfect failure that you've been dreading. Yeah, I am that. I am the one. I am that. I am that perfect pressure. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure that stands up to that, to your pressure. I am that perfect failure. Hey, world, I am that perfect failure. Hey, personalities, I am that perfect failure. Hey, bodies, I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect failure. So when we identify with this, we're able to identify with Jesus. Jesus is that perfect failure. He said, I am that perfect failure. Yes. Cannot stray. See, he cannot stray. I cannot stray. You cannot stray. Spirit cannot stray. Spirit cannot stray. It's impossible. There's just one spirit, one mind, cannot stray. So if you're still following along with these videos, it's a great blessing. This is a great blessing to get to this, to get to this. And as you sort of, you know, the personality be screaming at you, what are you doing? What are you talking about? You're crazy, you know, like that. Not true. It's the personality that's crazy. And you're standing up to its craziness, saying, hey, personality, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. There is this darkness that is not dark. There is this darkness that is not cold. There is this darkness that is not frightening. And this is how we stand up to the pressure of this fake electromagnetic light. Okay, this electromagnetic light is the light of a dream, is fake dream light. There's a darkness that isn't dark. I am that perfect darkness that isn't dark, you see? I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. Now the ego freaks out. Because it says, no, there's electromagnetic light, this universe, this is my home, this is our home, this is reality, this home, what are you talking about, this is crazy. No, it's not, it's a dream of arrogance is all it is. So, to stand up to the pressure of that, you see, I am that perfect failure, I am that perfect darkness. See, I am that perfect darkness where fake light can never enter, you see. I am dark to fake light. You got it? I am dark to fake light, but really it's perfect clarity. The perfect clarity of knowing. See, it's really the perfect clarity of knowing. But we do, in this intermediate step, we stand up to the pressure. You see, we're symbolically, perceptually seeing ourselves as being untouched by the pressure of the dream, the fake light. Personalities, this fake strength, the arrogance, belief in strength. We see ourselves as not being, the pressure's there, but we're not touched by it, you see. So in order, we have to symbolize that some way. So I am that, yes, I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect darkness. Yes, I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. And again, this is kryptonite to the personality, to the fake, the dream of arrogance is kryptonite to it, which is exactly what we want. It's standing up to it, all right? Again, and then do not fall for the trick of arrogance, which says, well, why don't you just go directly into knowing if you're so right? Because of our continuity fear, arrogance, that's why. Jesus absolutely advocates this intermediate step. It's pragmatically necessary, okay? Because we have a continuity fear. So first we want to see that we can stand up to this pressure. And once we're positive and used to standing up to this pressure and being able to completely resist it, not to be touched by it, once we're totally certain of this and familiar with it, then we will go, God will take the final step for us, and we will simply go into knowing and drop all dreaming, all perception, all together. But that's a step that God takes. Our role that we still have to play is to symbolize this standing up to this pressure and being untouched by it. That is the role that we still have to play, all right? So don't let the personality get too smart for you, okay? It's not, it's being vicious, it's being arrogant when it does that. It's being, what do you call, spiteful, you know? And we don't allow that here. We do not allow that here. Which may seem like cutting off dialogue, cutting off questions, because that all comes from the personality. It does. It all comes from the personality. It's a delaying game. We have the assertions we can make. And so from this standpoint, we just practice. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. Thank you. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect darkness. Identify with that. The darkness which isn't dark. It's a symbolization of clarity, okay, which is a symbolization of standing up and where this electromagnetic light cannot touch it. Cannot touch it. Cannot touch it. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. The dreams we have are often the dreams of the personality. frantically trying to, like last night, my dreams were body thought dreams, you know. The personality was frantically searching for bodies. And I said, wow, that just shows you though how shocked the personality is and how it's fleeing, desperately fleeing, trying to flee this. It's not my personality. This is a dream of arrogance. It's just nothing but arrogance. That's all it is. It's the personality construct. It's the personality construct belief, okay, that bodies surround and encase a mind, you know. That's not true. There's no mind surrounded and encased by a body. We just imagine there is, and this imagined entity is what we call personality. It's all just the imagination of arrogance is all it is. It's all it is. So we have kryptonite for the pressure now, absolutely. And so we practice it. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I am not a body. I am free. I am a still spirit exactly as God created me. So these negative assertions that we have, these two negative assertions, are so powerful that the personality will never suggest these to us. And so we have to take this, we have to go, you know, withstand the pressure, which I've been able to do. It's very, very difficult to stand up to all this pressure. But I was able to stand up to it enough to get these assertions through now. So we have them here now in this world. Just in time, just before the universe tried to land a knockout punch on us. I landed a knockout punch on the universe. The grace of God did, for sure. Yes, I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect darkness. Yes, I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect darkness. And these are assertions that we thought we'd never ever hear here. We'd never get to them, and yet we have. So, whatever the universe wants to throw at us can't touch us. We have the kryptonite for that. We can stand up to that pressure. Absolutely we can. I am that perfect perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. And again, the personality cannot understand this, cannot accept this. The personality hates this. The personality reviles this. Personality withdraws from this, recoils from this. Personality recoils from this in horror. Says, you can't say that. It's horrifying. Yeah. No, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. Another perfect darkness means I can never be touched by fake light, by a symbolic light, by a dream of light. That can never touch the true light at all. It can never obscure it. We cannot bring obscurity into clarity. It's impossible. The clear light remains the clear light, always. See, it cannot be touched by electromagnetic light, by a dream of light. It cannot. So it's absolutely dark to the fake light. You see, absolutely dark to the fake light. So we're standing up to the pressure of the fake light. Yes, I am that perfect darkness. Yes, I am that perfect failure. Glad to meet you. See, that's the functional pragmatic identity that we have here. You see, that withstands this pressure. And that then we prove to ourselves and we become familiar with it. Ah, yes, this is true. It's truly, this is true. Truly, this is true. See, we must get ultimately to truly this is true. Truly this is, yes, truly this is true. I am that perfect failure. Truly, this is true. I am that perfect darkness. Truly, this is true. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect darkness. Truly, this is true. Again, Ananda Maima was actually the kryptonite that stood up to goddess worship. No matter how much they tried to worship her as a goddess, she was untouched by it. Absolutely untouched by it. And it drove them nuts. Drove them crazy. They'd dress her up as Durga. They'd dress her up as Kali. They'd dress her up as a goddess. You are the goddess. You are the goddess. And yet you looked at her. She's absolutely untouched by it. Absolutely untouched by it. That kryptonite to goddess worship. But of course, to express this kryptonite, she actually appeared as a body, at least as a body hallucination. We saw it as a body. She said she wasn't a body. That if you saw her as a body, you weren't really seeing her properly. There was no body there. It was more like a light body, actually. And so they tried to say, you are the goddess, you are the goddess, you are the goddess. You know, we worship you, but no. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. Never strayed from that. So the attitude, you could see the attitude's there, and yet, from the personality standpoint, the goddess is there. And yet, the personality can never succeed in actually turning her into a goddess. And it's going to cause the personality, it's like, what is this? So it's actually very helpful. Extremely helpful. For those who are ready to stand up to the personality, to the false light. It's kind of like the personality is attracted to this, oh, here's a goddess, and then like, whoa, there's no goddess here. What happened? It's like, freaks the personality out. But then spirit can say, no, it's the I am presence. It's the I am presence here. It's just the I am presence. Tough love, for sure. And the devotees say, "Ma, we need you as a body. We're not capable. When we know some great ones are capable, we're lowly and we're just these personalities and these electromagnetic personalities, and we can't." Do it that way. So we need you to be a body. We need you to be a goddess. We need to worship your form. This is what they told her. This is what they told her, and she just laugh at them. You'd laugh, smile. Says, go ahead, do whatever you want to do. Dress me up if you like. Put all these things in my hands. Dress me up as a goddess. Well, what have you got? I said, but Ma, we need you as a body. Yeah. Well, you just dress me up as an idol, right? What do you got? And I said, but I don't understand. Yeah, what do you got then? Well, yeah, failure. I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect failure. You see. So what have I got? I've got I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. No matter how many robes and flowers you put on me, what do you have? Perfect darkness, right? I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect failure. You can throw a million flower lace upon me and all sorts of ornamentations and jewelry and fine robes and silks and put me on a throne. What do you got? So there was always that attitude that she had that they couldn't touch. Complete detachment. Utter complete detachment. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. And finally, forget it. Let's just forget about it. Let's go find a better goddess. But somehow, this registered. Somehow it's registered. I was able to go through this whole consideration and pick up on it. And it's still difficult. It's still difficult. But it burns. She's like I'm the fire that will burn you, you know, to complete ashes. There's nothing left whatsoever. Meaning you keep trying to identify with the body, but it doesn't work. Keep trying, it doesn't work. Keep trying, it doesn't work. And so we have been brought through the, you know, combined efforts of these different teachers, really. And Jesus is the one who is the center of all this for me. But just like we're being hit from all angles right now in the world, okay? The pressure is coming from all angles right now, very bad. It's helpful to have these different angles of help from teachers, I find. But we have arrived now at the center, okay, where we can say, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. So I got help from also Ramana Maharshi, okay, the whole Advaita thing, where he transcended Advaita, transcended the concepts, all of it, okay. He just didn't say anything. Didn't need to say anything. And so, tremendously transcendent help right there. Just like, I am the embodiment of perfect failure, Ramana, you know. I am the embodiment of perfect darkness. I don't say anything. I don't move. I don't say anything. I'm completely still. That's just like tremendous help for the world. Tremendous. So, that's another angle. Then Longchenpa, another angle. Where his radical Dzogchen, the way that he was able to use words to express the absence of words is probably unparalleled. Unparalleled. And just reading his book, you know, his teachings, just considering and hearing this has an enormously positive effect upon us. It's just, wow! I would say the great master of the use of words, the use of symbols, the use of concepts, expressions, to cancel expressions out, to cancel words out, to cancel images out, cancel imagery out. You know, he's the, you know, absolute master at that. So this is another angle, you see. So I've had these four beautiful angles, you know, to help out, to get to the center, to help get to the center. I am. Yes. Yes, yes. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. That is what I am. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. Now, this goddess worship has made inroads within Christianity. Christianity has been targeted and termited and sabotaged and taken severe blows. And quite frankly, most Christians are stumbling. They are starting to, they've got, not starting to, they're having trouble accepting Jesus' true message. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. And they're turning into prosperity consciousness, a lot of them. Okay. So, it's always possible, the personalities can always sabotage any particular approach. But when you get this play of approaches from different angles, the personality doesn't know what to do. It gets confused. It you know, right? It gets confused. Here's Longchenpa. Whoa, what? And here's Jesus. Whoa, and here's Anandamayima. Now here's Ramana Maharshi. Here, you know, and go back to Jesus. Back to Longchenpa. Back to Anandamayima. Ramana Maharshi. Like this. And the personality just like, yeah, just doesn't know what to do. doesn't know what to do. So I find this collaborative approach to be the effective one. I find that those who are locked into one approach, that the ego tends to co-opt it, and become very provincial, very fanatical. And of course we see this at play in the world right now. There's some extreme religious fanaticism at play. The ego has managed to throw them into this fanaticism, and we certainly pray that they recognize this. You have to guard against that. It's trying to be too smart. There's the personalities in charge, trying to say, hey, you can just force this upon everybody. It doesn't work that way. You have to embrace it. We have to embrace it. It cannot be forced upon us. That's the personality. Okay, so we say, yes, I am that perfect failure. This is something that I am embracing and accepting for myself out of wisdom and clarity. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. There's nothing that anybody can force upon you externally. This is coming from internally. I'm accepting it internally. My mind, my spirit is accepting this, okay, as the sovereign remedy. But I got to this through this ecumenical approach, this truly ecumenical approach. I welcomed help wherever the help, I opened my mind, I said, whatever can truly help me, I welcome this help. You see, and then these four main pillars of help have helped me. When the ego tries to make inroads here, whoops, I'm over there. Then it tries to here, whoops, I'm over here. And it can never catch up to me. It can't, can't pin me down. Can't pin me down very easily, right? If it tries to trap me into goddess worship with an eye of my mind, gone. I'm with Jesus. Right? I'm with Jesus. I am that perfect. Yes, I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect darkness. Thank you, Jesus. Absolutely. When it tries to say, well, pin me down with Jesus and legalism and stuff, and I'm with Longchenpa. You see? Then when it tries to get me into intellectualism, Buddhist intellectualism with trying to let Longchenpa, I'm over with Ramana Maharshi, absolute stillness. Then when it tries to say, well, that's not really pragmatic, over to Jesus, and so it can't, it can't pin me down, And then this has led now to the sanctuary of, yes, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. And then this provides the oasis, the paradise, the oasis in a scorching hot desert. The world is a scorching hot desert, like Death Valley, like Coachella Valley. I checked what was the temperature last Thursday in Coachella Valley? 116 degrees. That's scorching. I'm telling you, that is scorching. That's ice on your head time. And yet, the image is, I have this beautiful oasis, sparkling cool water, perfect temperature, lush greenery, lush palm trees, lush flowers, lush greenery. And out there, the desert is scorching. And you say, I'm not touched by you scorching desert at all, am I? So this is the, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. The pressure cannot touch us. We see the pressure. It's there. The scorching desert is there. And look at the distance. Wow, barren, scorching desert. But where I am is this lush oasis. Beautiful, lush oasis. So peaceful and beautiful. We're just sitting there sipping our fruit drinks, our smoothies. I made a great smoothie last night. Strawberries, organic strawberries. Pureed, frozen, absolutely frozen, then puree them. And it's just this, wow. Add some apple juice, organic apple juice to that. And quite a nice smoothie. So we're sipping our smoothies. in the shade, air-conditioned shade, and just saying, ah, isn't this nice? I'm not out in that scorching hot desert at all. I'm not out in that scorching hot electromagnetic personality desert at all. I am that perfect failure to stray at all into that desert. I can't stray at all into that desert, can I? I cannot stray at all. I am that perfect, absolute, perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. I cannot stray. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I cannot stray into that harsh electromagnetic light at all. I cannot. I cannot. I am that perfect darkness. So, you know, the viewers may be saying, wow, this is like a paradigm shift. It is. It's a total paradigm shift. But this is what all this preparation was for, is to make this fundamental paradigm shift where we assert now that we cannot stray. We cannot stray. I am that perfect failure. I can't. I'm a failure. I'm a perfect failure at straying. I'm a perfect failure at straying into electromagnetic light. Right? I am that perfect darkness to the electromagnetic light, you see. And so, yeah, the imagery I have is this like glaring, harsh, you know, Mojave Desert, this desert, just sand dunes, and you just see, oh my God, it's so harsh, it's so terrible. And yet here I am in this gloriously wonderful, beautiful resort oasis, just like, wow. Sitting quietly, just wandering about, just saying, maybe I'll take some pictures or video, or just enjoy it. And it's not touching me, it's not touching me. And I can't stray from this oasis. I cannot stray. It's impossible to stray from it. I am that perfect failure to stray from it. I am that perfect darkness to that light. I cannot go into electromagnetic light. It cannot touch me. It cannot touch me. And the light that we have here is beautiful. It's this wonderful, soft, calm light. It's not the harshness, the glary light. It's just perfect light. You know, wow, ambience is so wonderful. That's the darkness that's not dark, right? So we have this oasis, we have this refuge, we have this refuge. Take refuge. We take refuge by embracing, making assertion from our own being. Yes, yes, yes. I am that perfect failure. Yes, yes, yes. I am that perfect darkness. Thank you, God. We can say thank you, whatever we want. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I am that perfect darkness. Yes, yes, yes. I am that perfect darkness. Yes, yes, yes. I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am blessed. I am that perfect failure. Yes, thank you, God, for the perfect blessing you've given me. I am that perfect failure. Thank you, God, for that perfect blessing you have given me. I am that perfect darkness. So, the turmoil will come from us at every direction in the world. This is how it is planned. This is what the personality has planned. This is what the ego has planned. This is what the logic of arrogance has planned for us. We've been warned. The Bible warned people about this, and other traditions also have warnings, okay? We've been warned. We've been forewarned. So, we are wise to it, and we are practicing, and we are taking refuge from it. It will come at us from all angles, which was symbolized yesterday, the 26th of June, 2015, by terrorist attacks in different places, right? Different angles, different places. There isn't any front anymore. See, we keep thinking that there's a front somewhere. Okay, I'm behind the front, I'm safe. No, it's a mobile front right now. It's a mobile front. It's fronts here, now it's here, now it's here, now it's here. And this is what's going to cause personality meltdowns. I mean, or we might say, it's going to cause distress. Okay, how to say it? People are going to, there's a desperation, there's a panic, there's a fear. It's going to cause this, you see, because as long as we think there's some front there, okay, there's the front, I'm behind the front, I'm safe, everything's fine. Everything's fine. I'm a sunbather from England on a beach of Tunisia. I'm fine. Everything's great. Whoops. This is the front. Suddenly this is the front. It is profoundly disturbing to us. We don't realize how this can destabilize us. Very destabilizing. And so we have the perfect stability here. Take refuge in perfect stability. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. And you could even say, I am that perfect instability. Meaning, I can never find any stability at all in arrogance. God has not allowed me, created me, to ever find stability, any stability at all, in straying. I cannot stray. No electromagneticness and no even iota of stability in the potential of no potential of strength. It just nullifies, completely nullifies it all, doesn't it? I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect instability. That I can never find the slightest stability to stray. You see, I can never find even an iota of stability to ever stray, to ever be touched by electromagnetic light. I can never find even an iota of stability for that. So I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect instability. There we go. We have three now, we could say. Can't touch that. You see, can't touch that. It's hammer time. Can't touch that. It's a cool day today here, relatively so. Cloudy. You know, low 80s. Next week is supposed to get very hot. I think Tuesday they said like 100. It'll probably be more than that, scorching. It's going to jump up. The whole week's like in the upper 90s, mid to upper 90s. We'll see. So, we beat the universe to the punch. Absolutely beat it to the punch. Now, I default back to Jesus, okay? I default back to Jesus. So, I'm not trying to try to say you should default some other way. I default back to Jesus. This is my central core teaching, teacher, etc. Default back to Jesus. But I'm also completely pragmatic and understanding that help coming from different angles adds to the effectiveness of Jesus. Absolutely. Absolutely. I see so many people trying to be dogmatic, and they're so stuck. It's very tough to get to these assertions. Very difficult. Personality will insist that you'll be annihilated if you do this, and then holds up an image of Jesus, an idol of Jesus, and saying, if you worship this idol of Jesus, you won't be annihilated. And you say, oh, thank you, personality. And you think the personality is the Holy Spirit is saving you from annihilation. It's not true. So inherently, there's a tendency for religions to get stuck in idolatry. And so what I find is religions helping one another out is the best way to go. That doesn't mean you don't have a core religion. My core religion is Christianity. My core religion is teacher is Jesus. But that doesn't mean that I cannot accept some help, some collaborative help from other religions. Absolutely, I have accepted. because I see that it's almost inevitable that we get stuck in idolatry, because we just can't imagine that the remedy that I'm showing you now, we just can't imagine it from the standpoint of familiarity. It just doesn't register at all. It just doesn't register. So we end up following the personality's advice, which is really the arrogance, and making an idol of the teaching and the teacher, and then worshiping that idol. And then we get stuck, and then when the collapse comes, we get pulled into this collapse, which is coming right now, and we start straying into goddess worship, which is the Roman Catholic Church is heavily into that, actually. The Pope has actually basically decreed he's let it be known that's where he's taken the church, by claiming it, Eve was blameless and it was all Adam's fault. That's goddess worshiping at its best right there. He announced that, meaning that's where he's taken the church, into goddess worship. The ex-Pope, Pope Emeritus, I excommunicated him already. And you can too. Try it. It's helpful. If you're a Catholic, that doesn't mean you have to stop being a Catholic. That you can excommunicate the Pope. Absolutely. The Pope is actually your servant. And if your servant turns out to be a wolf in sheep's clothing, excommunicate that wolf. Say, okay, Pope, but out of respect for the church, you say, okay, I'll make you Pope Emeritus now. Okay, you're Pope Emeritus. You don't say, out of respect for the overall institution, you know, you don't want to crack down too hard. So you say, okay, you're now, you know, you're excommunicated, no longer the Pope, but you're Pope Emeritus, and you've got your little place now. But you don't speak for me anymore. Okay, you don't speak for me anymore. I'm not going into goddess worship. Jesus is back. Jesus has already returned. So, you can absolutely still remain Catholic. You can still remain within your own tradition. That's no problem at all. These core sayings transcend any tradition. Actually, they're the heart of truth. Okay, you might say the heart of all tradition. I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect darkness. Yes, I am that perfect instability. So I cannot take the slightest step, because I'm completely unstable, I cannot take the slightest step to straying, you see? I cannot take any, even the slightest action towards straying, because I am that perfect instability to straying. God created me as not being able to have any stability whatsoever to ever straying. I am that perfect failure. I absolutely fail to stray at all. I am that perfect darkness. I absolutely fail to be touched by any fake light. You see? I am dark to that fake light. This is the very core, this is the very essence of withstanding the pressure that we must do. We must withstand the pressure. So, my recommendation is keep your core identification. Whatever your religion is, keep your core identification. No problem at all. Do not be threatened by collaborative help. Do not be threatened by it. Recognize you could have made an idol of your religion. You could have made idols, as very likely that everyone has, very likely. Because we just feel if we take this final step, which we need to take, we'll be annihilated. But remember, that's projection of arrogance. It's arrogance that's going to be not annihilated, but just simply realize we don't need it. It was just a silly game we've been playing. Pretense is all. We just set it down. We don't need it anymore. That's what will really happen, ultimately. And keep your core. Keep your core. Don't try to change that kind of horse in midstream. Keep your core. Personality might try to tell you, oh yeah, you need to change here. If you're a Christian, you got to become a Hindu. If you're Hindu, you got to become a Buddhist. If you're a Buddhist, you got to become a Muslim. If you're Muslim, you got to become this. Okay. You got to go Jewish or this. No. Just keep your core. Keep your core teaching. Keep your core teaching. Keep your core teaching. Just realize the heart of it. Just realize the heart of it. And don't be threatened by ecumenical collaborativeness. Not at all. when I made a prayer, I said, help, I feel like there's an angle that I'm vulnerable to. Help, 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 help. I prayed, whatever help that God, the grace of God can give me, I accept this help. I don't place any restrictions of form upon it or tradition or whatever. Complete open mind. And who showed up? Longchenpa. I didn't even know who Longchenpa was. No idea. The great Dzogchen, Buddhist Dzogchen master. I said, well, wonderful. He's super helpful. Okay? That doesn't mean I'm going to become a Buddhist. Right? He didn't say I had to become a Buddhist. Ultimate teaching transcends the form of any teaching, actually. It completely transcends the form of any teaching. So at the heart, you get this perfect ecumenicalness, which is even beyond that. And some people get angry and say, no, well, you're not a Christian. You're not a... Well, ultimately, I am that perfect failure. Right? I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect instability. And this demon stands up to all religious pressure that we have. Because a lot of religion is actually personality based in this world. A lot of it. And of course, goddess worship is personality based. Materialism is personality based. Lipstick culture is totally personality based. Atheistic, secular, humanistic materialism, totally personality based. So dream is totally personality based. So yeah, and most religion is personality based to some extent, although religion weakens the personality identification. It helps weaken it. Ideally. So if you're a Christian, absolutely remain a Christian. The core truths do not contradict. Jesus said, oh, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect instability. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for creating me this way, in such a flawless way. Thank you, God, for creating all in such a flawless way. So we have to keep at this. We have to keep at this one step at a time. There's no question that the world is putting us under extreme pressure at this time. In many insidious ways, trying to get you into details, counting details, instead of pure abstraction, you see. Whereas we practice pure abstraction, I am that perfect failure. I am that immaculately perfect failure. I am that total, complete, immaculate, perfect failure right now. I am that failure. I am that perfect failure right now. Yes, I am that perfect failure right now. I am that perfect darkness right now. I am that perfect instability right now. Now, the great good news is that there's at least someone here who will accept you saying these affirmations. You know, part of the problem is you think if I say these affirmations, I'll be completely rejected. There won't be a single person on this planet that will accept this. That everyone will reject me. Nobody will accept this. And so we say, oh, I can't say it. I can't say it. I can't say it. Well, at least there's one here who won't reject you at all for saying this. In fact, will encourage it. Absolutely accept it. So this starts some momentum, you see, like, wow, we're not all alone. We won't be totally rejected. Now, I was able to say these because I feel Jesus won't reject this. I feel Jesus absolutely accepts this. I am, yes, I am that total failure. Yes, I am that total darkness. Yes, I am that total instability right now. Yes, I am that total failure right now. Yes, I am that total darkness right now. Yes, I am that total instability right now. So I can say this because I feel very sure that Jesus is saying yes, yes, yes to that. Yes, yes, yes. Great job. Yeah, great job. Wonderful. So the more that start accepting this, say, yeah, I accept this. If you want to say this, I'll celebrate with you these assertions with you. I'll celebrate these assertions with you. Then I think there will be some in the world who start saying, wow, I can do this. I'm not completely isolated. I won't be completely isolated or excluded. There's someone who realizes I'm not crazy. The personality says I'm absolutely crazy. But there's someone here in the world who will not say that. They'll say, this is the height of sanity. This is great. Let's celebrate your sanity. Let's celebrate your sanity. By all means. Yes, yes, yes. I am that perfect failure right now. Yes, 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 I am that perfect darkness right now. Yes, 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 I am that perfect instability right now. Thank you, God. Now, the personality hates collaboration because it makes it feel very vulnerable. It doesn't, so it tends to be very dogmatic and provincial and say, no, you know, nobody else, this is the only one. The ego wants to identify one threat to it and say there's no other threats. This is its hope. You know, so it says Jesus is the only threat there is. The personality will say, Jesus is the only threat there is. There are no other threats. So I can, you know, feel that it can sabotage this threat. Whereas if there's all these other threats too, the ego says, "Wow, I, you know, I can't. There's fronts. Where's the front? Where's the front?" You know, the ego from the ego says, "I don't see any front. It's all over the place. I can't." You know, so the ego tends to be very dogmatic. Say, "No, no, 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 no. My, you know, this teacher is the only one. It's the only threat to me." There have actually been many who've accepted that I, yes, 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 I am that perfect failure right now. I am that perfect darkness right now. I am that perfect instability right now. And an ecumenical culture is the greatest threat to the ego of all. There's a teacher here. There's a teacher there. There's a teacher there. There's, you know, there's realization here. That, you know, what does the ego do? It's, where's the front? I can't find it, you know. So it tries to boil all down to just one threat. Okay, so basically the personality wants to say, no, Jesus is the only threat there is to me, and I'm going to, therefore I'll be able to intensely work on sabotaging that threat. Turn it into Jesus into an idol. An idol of success. An idol of success. Idol of universe, worshiping the universe. An idol of worshiping the world. An idol of worshiping the body, an idol of worshiping success. That's what the ego wants to do with Jesus. So if it only has this one focus, it can really seem to make a lot of progress, in, not in actually doing it, but in building up the pretension that it's doing it. So yes, yes, I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect darkness. Yes, I am that perfect instability. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you, God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. And thank you. Thank all those who have helped and support this truth. We thank all that support this truth. We thank all that are in support of truth. We thank all that are in support of truth. And we thank the truth of what we are. We're grateful for the truth of what we are, of what is. We're grateful for the truth of all that is. So, we've got this in place now. Before the Greek, whatever unraveling, you know, whether it be brinksmanship or whatever, they're trying to destabilize, but we're not fooled by that. Now we have the tools. Beat them to the punch. Beware of Greeks carrying debt, so to speak, right? Beware of Greeks carrying debt. And of course, again, we wish the very best for all the Greeks, and we're sharing this knowledge with them now, spiritual knowledge, so they can center in and be not troubled, be untroubled. There's a lot of depression and despair in Greece, and it could become very volatile actually. And for their sake, we share this practice with them and with all the world. Yes, I am that perfect failure right now. Yes, I am that perfect darkness right now. Yes, I am that perfect instability right now. We share this with all the world. Everyone has access to this video. And by saying it mentally, I'm actually sharing it with the whole world, actually the whole universe, with all there is. It's being shared with all there is already. And plus, this video is available to anybody in the world who has a, you know, internet connection. They can get it word of mouth, too. So it's already shared with everyone. Chimes are being picked up by this microphone. Inconclusive. But I do hear a white noise hiss, which is nice. Maybe a little bit of chimes, right? If you listen carefully. Beautiful background ambience here. There's a cicada background. White noise buzz too, which is very nice. I love the cicadas that give that white noise. We don't realize there's all sorts of white noise going on. Just the wind creates enormous white noise. All the rustle of leaves and everything, it creates actually white noise, a blanket of white noise. When we get in a situation where it's really still, where there's not a breath of air anywhere, no sounds in the airplanes, nothing, just absolute, then we like suddenly say, whoa, what's wrong, what's going on? It's startling, right? We're used to this ambient white noise. I think it's the cicadas during the day and the crickets at night. I like the crickets at night too. Chirp. Jab, 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 jab. Beautiful. And the frogs and the crickets. I don't know how many frogs there'll be this year. Not much water anywhere, is there? Not in California, there's not much water. The weather in California is so good, you just can't really even quite fathom it or believe it. You get this mixture of inland air and Pacific Ocean air, and you get these areas where it's a gentle mixture of the two. And so it's not one or the other. Sometimes it tinges this way, and sometimes it tinges that way, and you get this soft ambience, you know, of the atmosphere. And you really just feel like sitting and enjoying it. And this is very much like what we're talking about, this oasis in that scorching desert of just sitting and enjoying our freedom from that pressure. The pressure's not touching us. There's a great delight in that. I've always loved that too. Where you look out upon a harsh environment, but you're in a very safe, wonderful place. And you say, ah. That's why people like put their houses up on the coast over the ocean, and they see the storms and the waves and all of that, but yet here they are in this wonderful, safe, warm, cozy house, bungalow, cabin, you know, just saying, wow, we enjoy that. And that's something calling out to us, saying, hey, we can be in the universe, but not of it, not being touched by it. We can be in a desert, but in this beautiful oasis, when we practice, I am that perfect failure right now. I am that perfect darkness right now. Yes, I am that perfect instability right now. We can all find this inner oasis. So, there's a great need for people all around the world to do this. Greece is a great example of that. There will definitely be a strong need for those in those in Greece to establish this inner oasis so other Greeks can feel that and start taking refuge in that. There's a great need for people in every country of the world to practice this way. Yes, 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 yes. I am perfect failure right now. Yes, I am perfect darkness right now. Yes, I am perfect instability right now. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you, God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you all who are in support of this truth. I thank all in support of this truth, or in support of this truth. All thanks to the perfect support of this truth. I am that perfect failure right now. I am that perfect darkness right now. I am that perfect instability right now. Now, it may not resonate. This resonates spiritually with everyone. It doesn't resonate with the personality at all. So, you'll have the situation, the personality says, you know, yuck. Whereas spiritually you say, yes. And then the personality say, well, can't you please both of us? It's not fair to me. It's not fair to the personality that you can't please both of us. I say, how can truth please lies? You know, cannot, right? I cannot stray. So to say that I can stray is a total lie. I cannot do it. I cannot. So I cannot please both the personality and spirit. It's impossible. But what's really work is the continuity fear. Saying, oh, can't you help me out with this? Yes, of course. Well, that's what we're doing here. We're not dropping all perception, conceptualization, words. We're still saying, yes, I am perfect failure. Right now. Yes, I am perfect darkness right now. Yes, I am perfect instability right now. So there's a need for those all around the world to practice this way. And then when you establish this oasis about you, others will be attracted to this, say, wow, I feel like some kind of peace of mind refuge here. And I'm attracted to that, and I'm not attracted to what the personality is doing, trying frantically to agitate and produce fairness. It thinks that it's superior. Arrogance says, I'm superior to God. I can be fair to both truth and lies. I can love both of them. They're both satisfactory to me, you know, to spirit. Or it says, well, I'm both personality and spirit. I'm both form and formless. I'm both that. No. I am that I can both stray and not stray from what I am. It's not possible, right? If we are perfect failures at straying from what we are, how can we also then say that we are great successes or successes at all in straying? Those two are mutually exclusive belief statements. They cannot both be true. Cannot both be true. This is the heart of understanding. They cannot both be true. So there's this worldwide need. This is what I've been trying to help people from all over the world. I hope what I want is people from all over the world, all countries, to practice this way and allow this oasis to form around them as if they are untouched by what's going on, you know, untouched, cannot be touched by it. And then others will be attracted to this, and they'll start being these centers of refuge all over the world. Now the Holy Spirit knows this. I hope the Holy Spirit brings as many as possible into these videos. But who knows the Holy Spirit's timing and when it does. It's inscrutable that way. So I cannot say what it will do. This is how the world can be helped, actually. It's the only real way. And again, we say, be keep your core, right? And also, thank the ecumenicalness. Thank all those who have, you know, accepted the truth of their being. Thank all those who accepted the truth of their being. And if some help comes to them, thank you, thank you, thank you. They're not saying to abandon your core at all. The Nanamayama, Longchenpa, and Ramana Maharshi have never said one iota, have ever intimated one iota that I should stray from my core, from Jesus. Not once. Nanda Maimad told people, came to her, don't stray from your core. So what are you? You're a Christian? Stay a Christian. Follow Jesus, she said. Keep your core. whoever came to her said, what's your core? Keep your core beliefs. If it's a Muslim, keep your core belief. Okay. If it's a Hindu, keep your core belief. If it's a Buddhist, keep your core belief. Keep your core. Okay. You're not being asked to change that at all. And she'd say, just for me, just what I want you to do is keep practicing more in your core. Enhance your practicing. This is their message. Enhance your practicing. Enhance your practicing. Work at it more diligently. She didn't really have any teaching that you can identify really with any tradition, actually. She just say little aphorisms like, if you truly want me, then I am one with you. If you want to be, if you are very interested in me, then I am near to you. And if you're not interested in me, then I'm a beggar to you. Okay, let's go over that one more time. If you truly love me and want me, then I am one with you. If you're very interested in me, then I am very near to you. If you're not interested in me, then I am a beggar to you. Speaking from the I am standpoint. Always, she always spoke from the I am standpoint, really. If you look at it, and all those who have realized the truth of their, accepted the truth of their being, is not realizing, it's accepting. It's not like this has always been hidden from us and we finally realized, no. We tried to stray from the truth of our being. We've always been there. So we're just accepting, wow, I repent. So the real truth is not so much enlightenment or realization as repentance. Repentance is really a more key word than enlightenment or realization. It's much more accurate is we've always been as God created us to be. We've never strayed one iota from that. We've just been pretending that we can stray. That's all we've been doing. Arrogantly pretending that we can stray from the truth of our being. So it's just we're just accepting that, wow, I can't stray. That's all. So that has a much stronger impact to say, you know, repent, repent, repent. Whereas enlightenment can easily get pulled into the personality of saying, oh, I'm in an evolutionary path where I'm increasing my consciousness, and ultimately my consciousness will be so perfected that it'll finally reach perfect consciousness. You know, that's all personality, egoic stuff. Okay, that's nonsense. I'm perfect right now. I've always been perfect right now. All has always been perfect right now. There's no evolution of perfection taking place. So it's easy to get pulled into the personality when the term used like enlightenment, realization. Like I finally realized what I am. I've been on some that I started out incapable of it, and I finally developed the abilities or something. It's easy, you know, those terms can also be true, but they lend themselves to egoic personality misinterpretation to a very large extent. Whereas repentance, repent, you know, I made a mistake in thinking I could stray. That's what repentance means. It means to admit I made a mistake in ever believing I could stray in the slightest bit. I made a mistake, and now I'm accepting this fact that was a mistake. This is what repentance means. I feel this has a much stronger pull into truth, much stronger pull. So Jesus used this term, repent, 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 repent. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. It's right here, right now. You never strayed. You're incapable of straying. Where the personality say, yeah, I can stray, but I can find enlightenment within this straying. I can find enlightenment within the electromagnetic universe. I can find happiness there. I can find happiness in the stability of straying, in the stability of electromagnetic universe. I can find stability. I can find successful stability. No, that's impossible. So we have to be very careful about these positive terms of enlightenment, realization. It's better to use these negative terms of repent, repent, repent. Yes, God, I did make a mistake in thinking I could ever stray from what you created me as. It's impossible. I made a mistake. It was all a pretense, all folly. quaint silliness. We're eating Neapolitan ice cream last night. It's hard to say which flavor is better, you know. They're all good, you know. They're all good, but maybe the chocolate, you know, it's like, it's really good. They're all great. But I would suggest repentance is a very effective way of looking at it. We must guard against the false positive. We must guard against the false positive here. The false positive trips more of us up than anything. This is the great barrier, the false positive, that the personality, the ego, arrogance has been able to hoodwink us with the false positive. Like, hey, yeah, you can all be enlightened. Yeah, let's pursue enlightenment. I don't need to pursue enlightenment. I cannot stray from what God created me. I cannot stray from my own perfection at all. That's the truth. As Jesus says, you cannot make illusions true and then defeat them or choose among them, or, you know, that way doesn't work. You cannot make illusions true and then get rid of them. That's not possible. So I've never strayed. I have never strayed. Repent, repent, repent. I have never strayed. I don't need to be enlightened, I just need to repent. So beware the false positive. That's the trickiest mirage of all. And take refuge in practice. Don't look to defeat the ego. Just look to assert the truth. Ego is very clever. It knows how to use false positives to undermine you. That's its stock in trade, is false positives. That's its ultimate weapon, as it were. So repent, repent, repent. Yes, I repent. I am that perfect failure right now. Yes, I repent. I am that perfect darkness right now. Yes, I truly repent. I am that perfect instability right now. So yes, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect instability. And this is something transcends body pleasure. It's an oasis that transcends body pleasure. It's an oasis that feels like, wow, this is better than anything the universe can give me. It's better than anything the universe can give me. Being untouched by the universe is the one thing the universe can't give us, right? And it's better. Being untouched by the universe is something better than the universe can give us. Absolutely. The universe can hardly say that it can give us the gift of being untouched, perfectly untouched by the universe. And it's a liar when it claims it can do that. It cannot. Constantly lies to us. Says, yeah, I can do that. Well, what else can it do but lie? It can't do it. So, to maintain its plausibility, it has to lie. It says, oh, yeah, I can do that. That the universal I says, I can do that, sure. Yeah, I can give you the gift of being completely untouched by the universe. But then it'll say, yeah, but of course at the same time you are being touched by it too. And that's only fair. Then it brings that part in. Well, it's only fair that you also be touched by it. You know? So it'll say, well, I can bring you fairness. Well, I didn't ask to be brought fairness. I asked to be brought untouchedness. See? This is why we have to be very careful about the false positive, like fairness. Okay, I'm not asking for fairness. I'm asking for untouchedness. That's better than fairness. Who is the universe to accept, demand that I accept fairness when I can have untouchedness? I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect instability. I am that perfect untouchedness. Right now, right now, right now, right now. Ego lies. Arrogance lies. It says, yes, I can do that. But then it says, well, but to be fair, I also have to do this. I mean, you don't want me to be unfair. I said, not asking you for fairness or unfairness. I'm asking for untouchedness. So you keep bringing up this issue of fairness or unfairness. Like, you don't want to be unfair. No, I'm not even asking you for that. Apples and oranges. I'm asking for an apple, and you're saying, well, here's an orange. And, well, there's this sort of orange and that, and arguing about oranges. I don't care about that argument. I care about untouchedness. That's what I'm asking. You can't do that. You can't give it to me. Because you're equivocating. You're off on a different issue altogether, of fairness. I'm not asking for fairness. That's not the topic. I'm asking for untouchedness. And untouchedness, there's no issue of fairness or unfairness. There's no issue at all. I'm untouched. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect instability. Right now. Perfect untouchedness. And the universe say, well, that's not fair. I can't do that. Well, no, it's not unfair. It's that you're fraud. It's you're fraudulent. That's what the problem is. Not unfairness, it's fraudulence on your part. It's not me being unfair, universe. It's you being fraudulent. We could turn that around and say, yes, I am that perfect unfairness. So we could say, yes, I am that perfect failure right now. Yes, I am that perfect darkness right now. Yes, I am that perfect instability right now. Yes, I am that perfect untouchedness right now. Yes, I am that perfect unfairness right now. All right, so co-opt the ego's coercion. Co-opt the coercion. Co-opt the coercion. And say, yes, I am that perfect unfairness right now. Right? I can never be fair to lies. I can only always be perfectly unfair lies. Thank you, God. Right? I am that perfect unfairness. And this takes the wind out of the ego sails, you see. There's all sorts of very strong wind now. And yet, here where I am, calm, peaceful, just a gentle breeze here. A little haven here. So yes, I am. Yes, I am that perfect unfairness. So, we will see what the Holy Spirit will do. First, I have to be secure in these assertions. We have 5 assertions now that seem to cover a lot of territory, you see. Take the wind out of the ego's sails. Yes, yes, yes. Yes, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure right now. Yes, I am that perfect darkness right now. Yes, I am that perfect instability right now. Yes, I am that perfect untouchedness right now. Yes, I am that perfect unfairness right now. And rest on that. Those are the 5 flavors of ice cream. They're all good flavors, aren't they? And the ego says, well, pick them, choose them on, what's the best? I say, I can't. Well, that's unfair. Say, yes, I am that perfect unfairness right now. Yes, I am that perfect unfairness right now. So, you know, what the Holy Spirit will do, I don't know. The Holy Spirit is the perfect inscrutableness right now. Yes, I am that perfect inscrutableness right now. Problem with positives again is you try to imagine what they're like, whereas in negatives you don't. I am just this perfect unfairness right now. I don't feel my mind trying to imagine anything about it. When I do these assertions, I'm not trying to imagine anything. Jesus always tells us, well, we're making positive assertions. Well, try to imagine what the light is like, or you know something. Well, when I try to do that. That blocks it. I don't want to try and imagine anything how it is. But so why did Jesus bring in some positive assertions? Because you can't get directly to these negative assertions. It's too difficult. You have to start with the positives. But ultimately, he says you have to give up all, you know, concepts, thoughts, the positive and the negative. He makes a point to point out you have to let go of the positives. It's very important. So if you try to imagine peace, what happens? You're not peaceful, are you? You're trying to imagine it. You're trying to turn it into an image or a concept. So we have to try it and be free of not trying to do that. So yes, I am that perfect failure. You know, what can you imagine about that? Really nothing. My mind doesn't, no concepts arise out of that, really. I am that perfect failure. It's just like, ugh, what concepts can arise? I am that perfect failure. It sort of stuns the whole conceptual apparatus, doesn't it? I am that perfect darkness. You know, what can you imagine? Nothing, right? So it really knocks out the imagination, knocks out conceptuality, knocks all that out. Your thinking knocks your thoughts out. But again, I did a lot of work with positive assertions, and it helped keep the momentum going until I could finally get to these negative assertions, which is extremely difficult to get to these. So teachers do bring up positive assertions, but ultimately, I believe you have to get to these negative assertions. It's just very difficult. It's like the mountaintop. You could get to the mountaintop directly, but our continuity fear prevents that, really. So we hiked to the mountaintop. But once we're on the mountaintop, then we can say, wow, yes, I am that perfect failure. Yes, indeed, I am that perfect failure. Celebrate it. Be elated about it. Be happy about it. I am that perfect failure. Yes, 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 right now. I am that perfect failure right now. This is tremendous. I am that perfect failure right now. Hallelujah. God be praised. I am that perfect failure right now. Hallelujah. God be praised. And really, for me, there's no image that arises. There's no thoughts that arise from this. It's just a feeling that arises. And this is what ultimately we have to get to, is the feeling. Allow the feeling to arise. So, yes, I am that perfect failure. Hallelujah. Praise be to God. And when we try to fixate conceptually on one, we slip to another. I am that perfect darkness. Hallelujah. Praise be to God. I am that perfect darkness right now. Hallelujah. Praise be to God. I am that perfect instability. Hallelujah. Praise be to God. I am that perfect instability right now. Hallelujah. Praise be to God. I am that perfect untouchableness right now. Hallelujah, all praise be to God. I am that perfect unfairness right now. Hallelujah, praise be to God. So instead of arguing, instead of getting angry with anything, go into these assertions and says, yes, yes, yes. These are all super positives, avoiding the false. They're super positives in that they avoid the false positive, you see. This completely knocks out the false positives, which is the greatest barrier of all, the trickiest barrier of all, which has caused so many to get stuck for so long, stuck in false positives. And then they're still very vulnerable to arrogance. The issue of fairness. Well, you got to be fair. No, I am that perfect unfairness right now. Hallelujah, praise be to God. All praise be to God. perfect failure right now. I am that perfect failure right now. I am that perfect failure right now. And the ego says, well, you failed to solve this problem. Yes, I am that perfect failure right now. Well, you failed to bring us into the light. Yes, I am that perfect darkness right now. Well, you failed to be touched by peace and bliss. Yes, I am that, let's go back to instability. Well, you failed to bring stability to the world. Yes, I am that perfect instability right now. Well, you failed to be touched by peace and bliss and calm. Yes, I am that perfect untouchableness right now. Well, just, you know, not being fair to me at all. I said, yes, I am that perfect unfairness right now. Hallelujah, praise be to God. Full stop in the way of this. So, see, if you do these practices, at least there's somebody who will acknowledge and agree with it, won't call you crazy at all. Don't try to please the ego. Just say, I am that perfect unfairness right now. I am that perfect unfairness. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect instability. I am that perfect untouchableness right now. Well, that's not fair. Yes, I am that perfect unfairness right now. But it's still unfair. Yes, I am that. I am still that perfect unfairness right now. So I'm not a body, I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created spirit to be. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created spirit to be. I am not a body, I am free. For I am spirit. For I am still spirit exactly as God created spirit to be. I cannot stray. I cannot stray. I cannot stray. I cannot stray. I'm a perfect failure at straying, right? Yes, I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect failure. So, I don't know what's going to happen with me next, with the world. What? I don't know. Don't know. I do know this is super profound, super saturated with grace. But beyond that, I don't know. There is this like perfect breeze. I'm feeling this right now. It's just like the most ideal breeze imaginable. It's both cool and warm at the same time. I asked Longchampa in the dream when he came to me first and introduced, said, I'm here, you know, I said, how was your trip across the ocean? I saw you walking across the ocean. And I said, is the ocean cold or warm, or which is it? He said, it's both warm and cool. It's both warm and cool. It's warm and cool. It's warm and cool. That breeze I just got was both warm and cool. We could say that the vision of oneness is like perfect white noise. We're not quite ready for absolute stillness yet, so it's this perfect white noise. We could just use that as an analogy. There are a lot of analogies, but analogies are not the experience itself that it's pointing to. Greece's economy is based on tourism, really. They don't really have much GDP in the way of exports, so the problem is if they devalue their money, go into a terrible depression, recession, monetary chaos, you know, tourism may fail, you know, and if that tourism fails, then they're like in a debt spiral there. It's not like Argentina has a big tons of natural resources that could produce their way out of their default. Or defaults, plural. They continually do so. So the Greek situation is not good at all. If all the businesses close and collapse and everything, you know, how are the tourists going to go there? They're not going to want to go there, right? That's the trouble. What is the time on this? It's still going. So that's this big trouble for Greece. Hopefully that's not the start of some black hole, some financial black hole. Could be, though. So, practice, practice, practice. Everyone around the world. There's only so much I can do. I mean, I'm doing my part. I have to let everybody else do their part. Can't force anybody. Let the Holy Spirit do its part, you know, which, again, is inscrutable. I cannot look into the Holy Spirit, what it's going to do. I don't know. So I'll just keep doing my part as best I can. And that's all we can do, isn't it? Do our part the best we can. And just let everything else has to, you know, we can only do our part as best we can. We can't force anybody else to do their part. Coordinating all this is the Holy Spirit's job. And it's so theoretically complex. It's not complex for the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit doesn't it's not burdened by time at all. Okay? It's completely unaffected by the concept of time. So it's not complicated for the Holy Spirit, but from our standpoint, it seems impossibly complicated. Holy Spirit always is perfectly in the now and sees everything clearly in the now, always. So it's not burdened by time the way we seem to be. So it can coordinate everything. It's just we cannot understand how that's possible. So, I've done my part here, and I'm interested to see what will happen next. I don't know. I've got to have an open mind. This is a very significant part, but still, you know, there's no way to judge what the Holy Spirit, what the coordination will be, what the orchestration will be like. I try to just keep an open mind. As we're moving towards further along in this video, just give you a chance to relax, cool down a little bit, take stock, realizing that you're still fine. All the threats that the ego, that arrogance threw at you are baseless, groundless lies, traceless lies. Is nothing but lies, you know, that's plain and simple. We don't have to explain this false dream. It's just a lie, that is all. When we find out, oh, the lipstick culture doesn't work, what's going on? It's not our salvation. What happened? What went wrong? Nothing went wrong. It was a lie, is all. It was just a lie from the very beginning. It lied to us, you know, we're being lied to. We don't have to obsess about what's going on in the world, the failure, you know, the trouble. We're simply being lied to, plain and simple. It's very simple. We don't have to go any further than that. We're just being lied to. Say, okay, fine. Now let's go back to our practice. That sums it all up. We're being lied to, plain and simple. The ego, arrogance, does nothing but lie. It's a liar, a deceiver, and a murderer from the very beginning. That's it. It's just been lied to. Now we're asserting the truth. And so keep it very simple in our minds. For me, I'd like to sit in Death Valley in this beautiful oasis and just look out at the Panamints, range of mountains there, this is beautiful. This is wonderful. I am that perfect failure. Wow, that's great. I cannot stray into that desert. And just keep experiencing this. Wow, I cannot stray. Wherever I go, the oasis goes with me. I cannot stray from it. I cannot stray in the desert. I have this portable paradise. And so wherever I go, it's with me. I cannot stray from it at all. That's fantastic. Just park it in Death Valley. 120 degrees, but not in this oasis. This beautiful, perfect breeze that's both warm and cool at the same time. It's like, wonderful. The atmosphere today is just fantastic here. If you think, it's cool, and as soon as you think it's cool, it suddenly it feels warm. Say, it's nice, it's warm. And as soon as you think that, you think, but it's cool. But it's cool. Isn't that nice? But it's warm. It's sort of like that. It's just right. And conceptually, we say it's both cool and warm, right? Because conceptually, perfection cannot be symbolized, really, at all, right? So, it's both cool and warm. People like to do this, like with cabins in the mountains. That's why they love to go up there when it's snowing, when it's blizzarding, you know, and then they're in their nice, warm fire in the fireplace, and the cabin is all warm and cozy, and they're eating great food, and they're looking out, and here's this like extremely harsh, terrible blizzard. That'd be very nice. Wonderful. Completely untouched by it. So have this portable paradise wherever you go. I'm completely untouched by all this harshness out there. Completely untouched by it. Yes, I am perfectly untouched right now. I am that perfect untouchableness right now. See, this weather right now, you cannot put a finger on it at all. If you were blindfolded and you didn't know where you were, what time of year it was, anything, and you were experiencing this weather, you could not place it. So you can say it's almost like transcendent of time, of space, place, process and form. It's like transcendent. And like, where am I? I don't know. I'm right here, right now. I'm in the only place there is, which is abiding in perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. Abiding in perfect darkness. I am that perfect darkness. Abiding in that perfect instability. I am that perfect instability. See, it knocks out symbols altogether, doesn't it? You can't say chaos is perfect instability, because there's the potential for stability constantly there. You see a potential, but I can't get to it. It's chaotic. But absolute, total, perfect, immaculate instability, there's not even any possibility of grabbing onto anything, you know. There's no way to symbolize it. Doing cruising along. I am that perfect instability. Could have an interruption here. We'll see. Instability. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure right now. I am that perfect failure right now. I am that perfect failure right now. So even though there are people coming and going and this and this and that, you see, we keep taping here. We don't stray from our perfect, our portable paradise here. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. She said, shh, don't say anything. Don't need to say anything. So we're far along here. How are we doing? Oh, we still have a little bit of time here to relax. The natives are getting restless. Some people like to have a house right on a game edge of a game preserve in Africa, where it's just the wilderness, the mountains, it's like, wow, it's like, you know, just like it was 100 million years ago, and yet they're in this safe cabin with wonderful food and plumbing amenities or whatever, and it's like, ah, I'm untouched by history, I'm untouched by wilderness, I'm untouched by, they cannot touch me, and the harshness cannot touch me. But these affirmations are even better. We'll have a portable paradise. Yes, we will have a portable paradise. Yes, we have a portable paradise. Yes, we have a portable paradise. Not dependent at all on the world or the universe. We have a portable paradise. A home that grace provides for us. An ambience that provided by grace of God. So yes, I am that perfect failure right now. Yes, I am that perfect failure right now. Yes, I am that perfect failure right now. Just looking at the counter here. They should make it bigger so you can see it at a distance. But we are getting close to, can't really see, yeah. Yes, I am that perfect failure right now. Yes, I am that perfect failure right now. Yes, I am that perfect failure right now. Yes, I take sanctuary in perfect failure right now. I take sanctuary in perfect failure right now. Yes, I am that perfect failure right now. I am that. I am that, 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 I am that perfect failure right now. 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 Even, and the good news, I am that perfect failure right now. And I get to go eat something now. Get to go eat. I have not eaten yet today, and it's 1 o'clock. 1 o'clock. Business before pleasure. Business before eating. See? Practice before eating. Practice before eating. Get up in the morning and practice before you eat. Very important. Practice before you eat. Practice before you eat. It gives you a good strong edge. It's really helpful. Food tends to make the mind go dull. So practice before you eat.